put up a video the other day. Linear thinking versus dynamic thinking. There's this book by Dan Ariely, Predictably Irrational, which talks about why we do the things that we do as human beings. And I think that would be a good book for many of you to pick up. Because I'm going to address some stuff in the YouTube community. And I'm going to use logic. Why does anyone make a YouTube video? I told you my reasons. Glendon 007 was designed for the express purpose to sell my information products, which I started in 2009. Video is going to be part rant, part educational, part observation, and just shit off the top of my mind. Over the years, it's morphed into other stuff. I have a few other channels, other things I'm working on, and it's pretty fun. But that was the original purpose. I've had no bones about it. Now let's talk about everyone else. A Resale Renegade actually put up a statement pretty much, you know, agreeing with me that, you know, everyone that has a channel is after something. Attention, views, whatever. There are some people who will purport to have you think that they're working in your best interest from a altruistic viewpoint, and I'm going to tell you it's 100% bullshit. Because, number one, making videos is time consuming. Making videos takes effort. Well, unless you use Google Hangouts, because you don't have the hardware to make videos, because Google handles most of the heavy lifting. They'll process the stuff and everything. But if you notice, I don't use Google Hangout. And the reason is, it's still going through changes. I've looked at it. It's great for getting together. But for my purposes, it makes absolutely no sense for me whatsoever. So that's why I don't use it. Once again, that's using critical thinking. Now, I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say it just straight up. The reason that there are people who are pissed off at me is not because I've done anything wrong. That has nothing to do with it. They're pissed off because they can't figure out how their videos don't have the reach, the influence, nor does it bring them some kind of currency. When I say currency, it can be money. Emotional currency, it could be all kinds of things. They are really pissed off because no one's paying them as much attention as people pay me. Now let's really discuss why. Going on with keeping to the theme of why do people do what they do. And I'm going to use the doggy do example. You're on the street, right? And you see some dog shit. Do you sit there and talk about the dog shit? Nope. Do you get on the phone and call up your friends and say, "Hey, there's some dog shit here on the street"? Nope. You keep walking by. Now, once again, understand, with keeping with the theme of why people do the things that they do, there is some emotional component. Because I will give you an example. There are several people who have degrees, who talk, who say things. They have business degrees and they learn stuff in business school. And it's like, well, you know, I learned this in business school and these are business principles and blah, 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 blah. Well, this is the thing. If you got your degree like 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, that information is fucking obsolete. It is completely obsolete unless you add it to the information base with continuing education and continue to increase your knowledge base. Based on the comments I've seen by these people, they haven't done that. Now, this is the real kicker. If your advice and information is so good, why don't you have the life that you want? Because this is something else I've noticed. Once again, going back to the videos that I did the other day, I look at backgrounds. These people are living in not really nice homes. they don't have a pleasant surrounding. I mean, if you're making money, wouldn't you, and you wouldn't have to have a luxury vehicle, you wouldn't have to live in a mansion, but I would think, using logic, your shit would be nice if you were successful. Am I wrong? You know, answer in the comments. If you have the ability to generate success in your life, wouldn't you like living in a nice neighborhood, drive a nice car, not once again, not a luxury car, but some clean, decent, well-maintained? Wouldn't you live in one of the better parts of town? Would you live in a nice place? Yes or no? I would think most of you would go, hell yeah. If I'm making money, I'm going to live in the nicest place I can. I'm not going to live in the hood just because I want to. I might live in not the most expensive place because I'm, you know, worried about my money. I want to manage my money better. But there would be signs of success. Now, I want you to do this, because this worked out really, really well last time. When anyone questions what I do, question what they do. And why are they doing it? Because the sham of, I'm just looking out for your best interest, was exposed several months ago. And a lot of people have pulled away from those individuals. And they sit back and they're like, why? I'm just a good person trying to help people out. Bullshit. Going back to the book, Irrationally Predictable, there is a certain urge or something. Everybody wants to shine. Everyone wants to be better. Everyone wants acknowledgement. People want compliments. I know my distractors, dissenters, haters hate the fact, and one even said that, ooh, I have information that's going to shut down this business. And that person actually led to me having one of the most successful months I've ever had since I've been online, doing the YouTube thing. So once again, thank you. So if that's shutting it down, bring some more shutdown. Please, please, please bring a little bit more shutdown. I can use it. My bank account loves shutdown. And I look at this and I was like, and that's one of the reasons that I've approached it totally differently now. And going off and calling people out. See, if you study the 48 Laws of Power, by me doing what I'm doing and really not mentioning them, not getting really caught up, it hurts them more. And this is the thing that cracks me up. The less that I do towards them, the more they hate me. I've had, one guy, like, he did a shout out, call out video. He emailed me like a bitch, like he was my ex-girlfriend or something. Like, let's talk about this. I'm like, you are a nobody. You are a nobody. You've done nothing in life. Why the fuck do I want to talk to you? It makes no sense. And that's the thing. Someone actually sent me a message that someone was saying, talking smack. I didn't watch the video. But my exact response was, this person is a nobody. He will remain a nobody. And within 6 months, he'll be gone. Because see, this is the thing. I'm going to do a series of videos like, you know, how to do YouTube videos, because a lot of people start off on YouTube from an emotional standpoint. There is no business ideology whatsoever. It's just like, I want to make a video and I want people to like me. I want people to watch me and I want people to love me. I want them to be my BFFF because I just want to be liked. And that's the reason the channels suck ass and really will disappear in the oblivion and in the avalanche of YouTube uploads. No relevancy. And after so many years, because this is another thing, I don't have a degree, and I'll just, you know, been open about that. But one thing that I have done that many degree holders refuse to do, each year that I've been alive, I've substantially increased my knowledge base. There was a stat that a lot of people after college, high school, never pick up a book again. Ever. So I look at the folks who are doing this stuff and then I go back to why they're doing it. Why are they so passionate going to the doggy doo-doo thing? Many of us see atrocious things. We see bad things. But we just walk on by. Why would someone spend their time, energy, and effort, quote unquote, looking out for the small guy when they don't do that in their own town for the small guy? They don't go to soup kitchens. They don't volunteer. They don't donate shit. But on YouTube, you would think that they are Mother Teresa and Father Benigan. It's like, yes, you know, I'm just out here looking for all the... No. There's an emotional component to why they do the things that they do. And when that emotional component isn't properly stroked, then that's when they turn into super bitch. That's when they have these extremely long, whiny, estrogen-filled emotional hangouts, and they go on and on and on. Now, this is another thing that's happened. All those individuals that really got caught up in that stuff, their businesses were hurt. I want you to think about it. It is hard enough to get up every day and be successful when you look at, you know, your life. Getting up, taking care of your family, it's a hard thing to do. And as I said the other day, that when you're successful, you don't have time for hate. You don't have time for crazy stuff because you're happy. So anytime you see some ongoing fuckery, understand this is a person that's not happy. A lot of the dudes, I'm going to just say it, they're not really attractive. So I'm going to say they're probably not getting any pussy, which gives them plenty of time to sit around and emotionally masturbate. That's my thought process, because some of the stuff I see, I'm just like, really? You're doing this on a Friday night? You're doing this on a Saturday night? Really? Why aren't you with your family? Why aren't you with your girl? Why aren't you with your husband? I mean, really, I would say girl, because typically it is not women who are keeping this stuff up. It's a lot of men who are acting like some women used to behave. Now, let's really get down to the core of why we do what we do. And this is how it ties in. Most people start a business because they don't want to work for someone else. There is no lofty ambition. There's no huge goal. It's just like simply, I don't want to work for anyone else, so I'm going to start my own business. Which to me is reason enough. That's very sufficient. But if you want to really crank out your success, you have to figure out why you are doing what you're doing. You really have to put a finger on it, because if you don't figure out why you're doing what you're doing, the bus is going to crash. The bus is not going to go too far. I mean, it may start off well because there's a fuel in the tank, emotional fuel, estrogen, so on and so forth, that, you know, it's really on the roll. But long term, most of the channels you see aren't going to make it 2 years. They're not going to make it 3 years, because once again, like I put out, I study YouTube. YouTube started in 2006. And if you look at the original YouTubers, the early YouTubers, all of those guys and gals that started and maintained and somehow figured out a routine, a character, some type of theme for the channel, at the low end, they're making like $1,000, $1,500 a month from AdSense. At the low end. And then the ones who killed it are millionaires from YouTube. You know, one of the things that goes on with embracing new technology, adopting new technology, and not being afraid of it. Now, it's much more challenging to hit a certain level on YouTube if you're not with the right theme. And I'm going to discuss that in another video. But the whole deal is, I sit back and I laugh because I don't invest a lot of time into other people, so to speak, into the hangouts. And, you know, for some folks, you know, it's like I'm not a friendly person. People email me. Let's talk. Oh, that's another point. I've heard someone say that every time someone emails them, they get back to them. Very telling. At the height of this channel, I was getting 1,000 unique emails a day. If you can answer 1,000 emails a day, please inform me your process, because you would not do anything else other than answer emails. And if you know anything about business, that's really not effective. 1,000 emails a day. Every day, 7 days a week. So if you're answering your emails, then your channel's really not that hot, because you're not really getting as much traffic as I did. And still do, because I mean, it's down to like 250, 300 emails a day now. But at its peak, it was killing me. I'm just going to own up to it. It was killing me. It was whooping my ass. So, with that, it's very easy to say that you do this or this, because not too many people are watching your shit. That's just it. If you go to the top YouTubers, they'll all put up, it's like, I just can't. They can't do it. They can't do it because the avalanche of emails is so large. But if you're only getting like 1, 2, 3, maybe 10, maybe 20 a day, yeah. And then there were some people who were getting more like that, and that was overwhelming because they were trying to run their business. So understand, when you are working on your business, working on your life, sit down and really, really, really think about why you're doing what you're doing. Are you doing it because you want a better life? Are you doing it because you want to make money? When I come on YouTube, there's always an intent. There's always a purpose. It's contrived like a motherfucker. It's a plan. It's an agenda. You better believe it. Every video, there's an agenda. And I'll tell you the agenda to this one. I am beginning to embrace the fuckery on the higher level. And let me explain what I mean by that. I now understand why these folks are doing the things that they're doing, which is 100% they're jealous and envious because they can't do what I'm doing. And they can't figure out what I'm doing. So instead of going like, oh, he's racist, oh, he's an asshole, I go, oh, he's a child. He's a jealous little child. And you know, with children, you have to have a higher level of understanding because they're immature and they really don't know how to govern themselves as adults. So you can't really be mad at a kid for being a kid. Even if the kid's 30-some, 40-some, 50-some, because chronologically means nothing. Chronological age means nothing when you have the mindset of a child. And you will behave like a child and be treated as a child. So I have a different take on the individuals. And really, as I said in another video, they're helping me. They're making me money. I mean, sometimes I feel like Big Willie Pimp with a bunch of little hoes. Because I'll share something with you. One person sent me, and I'm not going to say their name because a lot of people know this person. And they bought one of my products in the consult session based on the fact of the fuckery. That was the reason they bought. So the very thing that they were like, you know, they're trying to save, they've actually pushed people towards me. And once again, I want to say thanks. I mean, I have a larger customer base thanks to these guys. I mean, it's like awesome. They are making me money. And this is the thing. They're so childish. They can't help themselves. There's this experiment about, you know, opportunity cost, the marshmallow experience. It's like either eat a marshmallow now or wait a little while and you get two. But that childish urge to get it now, they can't sit back and be analytical, which is really funny since some of them claim to be deep thinkers and very educated and very knowledgeable about a lot of stuff when really they're full of shit. Because if they were knowledgeable, they would apply their energy and efforts in other avenues because, frankly, most of them suck on YouTube. Videos are boring as hell, and the only reason that people watch is they make the promise that they're going to teach them something to make money. And I've noticed that a lot of them are running out of steam. They're running out of energy like a battery that's been drained out because they've hit a content threshold. That's another reason that the fuckery ensues, because they don't have anything else to talk about of substance. They can't. And see, this is the thing. The resale YouTube community is extremely small compared to other communities. It is niche. The YouTube eBay community alone is far bigger than the reseller community. It's way bigger. Way bigger. And I would think the reseller community is a subset of the eBay community because there are way more, eBay is a powerful keyword because there's so many people into it. So reseller picking is extremely small. Now, Redneck Picker put out a video a few years ago, the others are coming, and I agree with him, but I see something that I didn't really see coming. Once people get into reselling and picking and see how challenging it is, the fallout rate is pretty high. It's not as high as the storage auction or as quick. It will be roughly, these guys just got tapped. Oh, no damage. I don't know why you're tripping. It is totally shaking out, because the thing is, also as a reseller, and I'll give you this information, there is only so far you're going to go working out of your house. This is one of the things I tell in the hustler, you know, some of the hustler mindset training. As a company of you, your income is going to be severely impacted and limited. You're not going to get to six figures, because you're going to wear yourself out unless you use something like Amazon FBA or have some other kind of automation to your process. It's just not going to happen. And that's the thing that these guys don't seem to understand, because they're sitting around and trading information and all this, and that's all wonderful, but you're not going to get to $1 million business doing that. It's not going to happen. And before we get to the, I'm not trying to build a bullshit. You're trying to get as much money as you can. You just don't know how to do it. So you tell yourself that you're not trying to do it, so you don't have to suffer the pain of being a failure. Grow up. Grow the fuck up. Because anyone that's not trying to create a $1 million business for their family so they can take care of their kids, get them where they want need to be, have a decent lifestyle, once again, not luxury, but decent, you're a fool. I don't want to hear this like, oh no, I'm not trying to be as successful as I possibly can be, because I just want to stay at this low level. I don't really want to get any higher than that, because, that's for other people. I don't want to do bullshit. You can't do it because you don't know how to do it. And once again, to why people do the things that they do. Everything that we do is an emotional decision. Everything is driven by emotion. And if you realize it about yourself, and you realize what emotions drive you, you can make yourself more powerful and more effective. And sometimes it takes falling down and knocking your face against the concrete. Because, like I said, I will speak on a higher level about these people, but I'll never address them by name because they're nobodies. I will never do a call-out video on one person. I will never do a attack video, or because this is the thing. 6 months from now, they'll be gone. When I was in the storage auction business, this was something that happened. A lot of the old heads wouldn't really talk to you. And this was an old storage auction world. The new one is mostly dominated by new people. They wouldn't talk to you for about 6 months because, well, 3 months, because mostly that was the period of time when people would come and go. They would come. Like one of my good friends, Sonia, said, for every 50 people that came out, one stayed. That is a much higher dropout rate. Now, I did a video, The Fallen, because people were upset because they weren't as successful as they wanted to be in the storage auction business, with little regard to how fucking hard it is. And that's one of the reasons that my book did well, because I automated and systemized a process that didn't have it. Now, there's all these websites, you know, but if you have the ability to go online and go back to the Wayback Time Machine and look at the number of storage auction resources online prior to 2010, there's not that many. Now, let's talk about markets. Now, someone said that I'm, you know, this is the big thing, because, you know, it's like, I have a business degree, blah, 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 but never started a business. When I created my first book, because I got this question from someone, did I do market research? And I did not, because I knew from experience that the market was huge. You know, 2009, I was one of the few people on YouTube really talking about storage auctions, and as one, two, three, I think four storage auction television shows, I don't know how many storage auction blogs attest, I was right. Market was huge. The interest was huge. That's the reason my first book did well. So I didn't do market research because I knew there was a market. Now let's talk about markets in YouTube. When I created Glendon 007, I knew there was a market. I knew it was a market. Didn't know it was as big as it was, but I knew there was a market. So I designed videos for a market that existed. What most of the fuckery crew does is design videos to teach people stuff they want to teach them with little regard if these people give a shit about it. Essentially, these educated people are making videos on topics and subjects that most people don't give a shit about. There are some that do. There's always a smaller or niche market for certain things. But I listen and I laugh because I'm like, you're talking about stuff. Because I have on this channel 670 videos that you can see with a total of about 780. A lot of the stuff that they talked about, I did my market research I talked about years ago, and I realized that people don't want to hear about that shit. That's why the videos are not available to watch, because they weren't getting any views. But that comes from knowing where the market is and not knowing where the market is. And I think the most educated fools are the ones who are the most obtuse, because if you knew what you were doing, you wouldn't do the things that you do. That is the thing that cracks me up. Now let's talk about YouTube and marketplaces. Now if you're going to do a YouTube channel, like I said, I'm going to do some YouTube videos about this. I'm going to do like a series because I get so many questions. How to start a channel? What kind of camera to use? I'm going to address that. If you really had the business knowledge that you claim that you have, you wouldn't make the videos that you make. See, this is dynamic thinking, because for one, there's a lot of ways to research YouTube. There's a lot of ways to figure out what's a good video to put up, what's not a good video to put up. I'm not doing that because I have the G-verse. I have a 4-year-old, actually in 4 days, it'll be 4 years old, channel where I can just go ahead and tag my videos, Glendon Cameron. I don't have to put any other keyword down there in the keyword box. Glendon Cameron, Hustler Mindset, The American Hustler. Those are my keywords because I have my own ecosystem. See, you are trying to leverage into an ecosystem, and I've built my own ecosystem, which is something I teach in the Hustler Mindset, which is a concept that is foreign to people who have certain degrees, because I recently met someone who went to a school, and they've changed their curriculum, and I think it was fucking outstanding, but you're taught to exist in a system, whereas what I talk about is creating systems and creating ecosystems and creating the sandbox and creating an environment that you can win in, which is a concept that's lost on you because you keep talking about stuff of how to work in a system because you don't have the talent, the intellect, the ability, or the chutzpah, the balls, whatever, to create your own. Because one, it's hard work. It's a lot of hard work. And it takes a certain intellect. And someone put in the comments, and I fully agree, the number one reason that a lot of these YouTubers who are against information, blah, 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 is because they can't do it because they don't have the knowledge base, the talent, or the ability. That's it right there. But with creating your own economy, with creating your own marketplace, you have to understand how to read newspapers and look at the economy. I will tell you, this new thing that I'm doing, how to make a living without a job, is something that I'm doing now that's going to benefit me immensely in about 2 years. I'll even share with you what's going on. We, you know, what I call the disruptive economy. You're going to have a lot of people who have great jobs right now. And due to technology, not to the fact that they don't have the right education, not to the fact that they are bad people or they don't work. No, that has nothing to do with it. You're going to be displaced because of technology, regardless of your education, credentials, whatever. Technology is going to knock your ass out of the ballpark. So I am creating this series, How to Make a Living Without a Job, because there's going to be this huge number of people who are going to find themselves without a job. Another thing is, I'm not going to talk about eBay and Amazon. I'm going to talk about actually, because the thing is, the things that make me the most money is when I create my own stuff. I did really well on the Amazon. I did really well with eBay. But I did fantastically well when I did private label furniture and Conundrum Publishing. When, you know, I'm all on the creator tip. And the thing is, these people can't teach you how to be creators because they haven't created shit. That's another reason they hate me, because they are followers and they know how to work within a system, which is a good thing. You need to learn how to work within a system before you can exploit it and work outside the system. Once you know the rules and laws of the system, then you can work outside the system. But when you have no orientation, no ability to create your own thing, all you can talk about is systems and other people. You don't have the intellect or the higher level of thought to go in another direction, because it's like, it's an information gap. And it's a huge, well, for some of them, it's an information canyon, because they can't teach you how to create your own thing. They can just teach you how, like, let's talk about it. You're only going to go so far going to garage sales and flea markets, and you could make six figures doing that. It's going to get substantially harder for the two reasons. Technology and information asymmetry is no longer apparent in the resale community. What I mean by that is, Joe Smo garage sale owner can find out the value of his stuff quicker than he ever could before. And as the years go on, more and more of these people are going to do that, and you're not going to get the deals that you were getting at garage sales. Once again, because of the economy. A lot of people are going to find themselves without jobs, and they're going to have to make money, and they're going to have to do these things. So, technology and the fact that the information asymmetry is not as prevalent as it was, is more and more people are going to figure out how to sell their stuff themselves, and they will not be present at garage sales. Within 5 to 7 years, and I could be totally wrong, I think most larger thrift stores are going to have a eBay Amazon department. They're going to hire somebody because it would make a ton of financial sense, and they're going to scan everything, and everything that needs to go in those channels will go in those channels. So you're not going to find this stuff at the thrift stores. That's one of the reasons that, other than Amazon FBA, because with Amazon FBA, you can kind of create your own thing. You can actually create a product, because that's what I'm talking about the whole month of August, is how to create digital products, how to create physical products, things that I've done both times. And it's more risk, it's more work, but the reward is there also, because I'm sitting here in the middle of the day making a video talking to you, and I'm also getting paid while I do this video. I am getting paid. I have money coming to me while I'm sitting on my ass talking information, talking smack, bitch slapping people intellectually, and I'm making money. There are people who are going to watch this video who are going to be more pissed off because they can't do the same thing. And the reason is not a talent thing. No, it's not a talent thing. It's not an education thing. It is a ego thing. Because one of the things that I had to learn, because I have a lot of YouTubers who are women that I watch, is a lot of men have an ego that is detrimental to their success. I will figure it out. If you were that smart, you would already have the life that you want. If you don't have the life that you want, you're not that smart. A lot of women realize that, and they look for mentoring, and they work. And I'm going to tell you something. There's this whole women empowerment network online that is incredible, and a lot of you don't even know about it, which is a marketplace. I'm telling you, it is huge. It is so huge. And I sit back and I look at it, and that's one of the reasons. And, you know, I do a little reselling. Reselling makes up a very small segment of what I do. Most of my income comes from consulting, and I consult a lot in the physical world. I have people all the time like saying, hey, you know, I saw your YouTube video. Could you do this for me? Could you do that? I make a lot of money consulting, more than selling books, more than the Hustler Mindset Project. But once again, when that little person who is a child was saying, I'm going to destroy his business, you have to know where my business is before you can destroy it. See, this is the thing. When I say YouTube is extremely powerful, mark my words, YouTube got me a consulting gig in Germany. See, that's why I make all these videos. That's why I'm working on the G-verse and I'm tagging my stuff Glenn and Cameron. Because there'll be this block of information of videos that people come in. And I'll tell you something else. If you make videos on YouTube, don't delete your videos unless it's just really shitty or it doesn't serve a purpose. If it's getting views, leave it up. Because a video that I made damn near 4 years ago is how I got the German consulting job. And I'll tell you, it paid me $2,400 for about 20 hours work. Not bad. Not bad money. And the person was happy, I was happy, and it was a wonderful thing. So, understand, when you're doing these YouTube videos, excuse me, to, quote, call me out, you're fucking yourself. Because you could do a YouTube video to build your business, to call a customer to you. And also, I'm going to tell you another little secret. If you don't have a real large subscriber base, when you call me out, not that many people are going to learn about that video. So you're emotionally masturbating. You're wasting your time. You're wasting your resources. And then the people that do hear about it, they look at your body of work, and then they're like, this person's an idiot, because that's what someone told me. It's like, I was looking at so-and-so's video, and he's talking about you, and I came over to your stuff, and your channel's way better. So, this is why I'm like, I'm in a really happy place, because it is funny how this stuff keeps happening. And, I'm sorry, it's making me smile because I've had so many emails about this stuff, and it just tells you that at large, the YouTube community is a great place, it's a wonderful place, it's an awesome place, and if you know what you're doing, and if you study YouTube, you can make a lot of money here. You can do fantastically well. But if you are a child, and you engage in emotional masturbation, you engage in jerk fest and hangouts, and all you do is talk about people versus issues, knowledge, then the results of your efforts will be nothing. Now, how smart is that? Oh, they're not smart. They pretend to be smart, because if they were, they wouldn't do the things that they do. Now, this is another thing. I'm going to tell you, there was a large company that came after me because of some videos I had, and it got legal. Guess who won? Yep, I did. So, understand, when you're making your stuff or you're doing whatever you're doing, you weren't first, you weren't second, you weren't third, you weren't fourth, you weren't fifth, you weren't sixth, you weren't tenth, you weren't 12th, you weren't 20th, you weren't 30th, you may not even be in the top 100 of people who've come after me in my life, because I can tell you this, when you're successful, people come after you. They come after you because success brings two types of people to you. They bring people, first and foremost, that are good for you. It brings people to you that can help you become even more successful. And that's really the larger chunk of the folks that come to you. The other smaller subset of evil trolls also come. And I really looked at it the wrong way my first 2 years on YouTube. And really, this year, I think I grew a lot more in that regard, because when I realized that these people were actually helping me more than they were hurting me, it was like, holy moly, I don't believe this shit. This is crazy. When you really look at the numbers and the metrics. And also, now that I have 4 years on YouTube, I have seen four cycles of people start stuff and go. They start and go. And there'll be more people. There'll be more people, because the thing is, men egotistically have this thing that they're smart, going to figure this stuff out. And when I became really successful is when I realized I was a dumbass. When I looked in the mirror, it's like, you're a dumbass. I got this from a female viewer. She said, you're the only man that I've ever seen that has said over and over again that I've made mistakes, I fucked up. She's like, I got a brother, he can't even admit that he made a mistake. He can't say it. You know, he'll make a mistake and act like it didn't happen. And that right there, my friend, will limit your growth. If you can't accept the fact that you made a mistake and you don't learn from those mistakes, not going to go too far. Just not. So when you want to figure out why you're doing what you're doing, you have to be emotionally honest with yourself. I wrote my first book as a self-indulgent, self-serving measure to make money. It also helped out people, but that was first criteria. I wanted to make money. I am one of those rare people that doesn't really think making money is this huge, emotional, crazy thing. Because you'll hear people like, you know, if you, like, I tipped someone $100 one time. They say, oh, that's too much. I was like, no, it's not. And let me tell you something. I gave it to you. You can't give it back. And take it and go. And she took the money and smiled. A lot of people feel that money's cheap. And also, I will talk about that in another video. That's part of indoctrination from the powerful. Read the 48 Laws of Power. If you have in you this ability that, you know, too much money or money's bad, that is indoctrination to keep you on a low level. That is indoctrination to keep you poor, independent, and always working to make the more powerful even more powerful. Because understand, the difference between you and that person that you may admire, whoever that may be, is they took action and they did not buy into the indoctrination. What's the lady that made Spanx? She made a garment to make women look better in their clothes. She became a billionaire off an undergarments business. Spanx, you know. She took action. She went out there and did her thing. You can do the same. So when you're sitting there on YouTube and you're getting ready to do your video, I want you to think about, why are you doing it? Do you want to make money? Do you want attention? Do you want to share your views with the world? What do you want to do? Once you figure that out and it's coming from an emotionally strong place and you are like, ah, that's why I do what I do, the results and the success may blow your mind. It may totally and utterly blow your mind. But as long as you are a fake person, and that's something else that's very ironic, the irony is just so sheer, you can see through it, is many of the people who said I was fake are actually the most fake people on the earth, because they're doing shit and they're not honest with themselves. That's fake. They juke themselves. You know how the guy does the double crossover, break your ankle cross? They did that to themselves mentally. They don't even know what they're doing. And they can't figure out why they're successful. They can't figure out why things aren't going that way. They can't figure out why a lot of members of the YouTube community actually turned on them. I saw it happen. I predicted it. It's like, oh, these people are going to self-implode. And they're like, we can't figure out. You know, we say some stuff and people just don't like us because you're dumbasses and you're saying the wrong thing. Sure, there's a little crowd of haters and small poor people. And when I say poor, I'm talking about mental poverty. And they hang out and they commiserate and they're just like, yeah, you know, life sucks. I'm struggling. You know, this shit's not selling. I get more non-paying, blah, 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 blah. Misery loves misery. And they just commiserate on that level. And that's one of the reasons that I did not join the posse. And I try to think how fortunate that I am that I can do this for a living, have fun, talk smack, and make money at the same time. When you really think about it, it's an amazing world. And I will tell you, the next 10 years will be fucking amazing if you have the right mental orientation. If you are mentally poor, next 10 years are going to be scary for you, because you're going to keep looking at not the glass being half empty, you're going to keep looking at there's no glass on the fucking table. You're going to feel that you're on the outside, you're going to feel that, you know, the world did you wrong, so many bad things because you don't have the right mental orientation. Something to think about. All right, this is Glendon. I will see you on the good side.